Start. So thank you everybody for coming. Okay, cool. So you are probably wondering who is this guy here in front of you. Hi everybody, I am Luciano. I work as a solution architect at Vectra.ai, a company that works in the space of artificial intelligence and network threat detection. And I live in Dublin, so if you are interested about this stuff, it's not related to my talk, but we can discuss about this later. You can find me online on Twitter, GitHub, LinkedIn. I also have a blog. And the thing that I want to mention about myself is that in the last 2 to 3 years, I've been involved in few side projects, and I really hope somebody ever heard of any one of those. And the first one is a book about Node.js and design patterns that I wrote together with Mario Casciaro. Then there is Full Stack Bulletin, which is a newsletter for full stack developers. And it's all built with serverless technologies and open source, so somehow relevant to this talk. And then there is Serverless Lab, which is open source training for people that want to get started with serverless. So please follow those amazing people. They work with me on this project, so you will find a lot of interesting links following them on Twitter. So what's the agenda for today? The first part of this talk is focused on the history of serverless, or it's more like the history of cloud computing from the age of bare metal to serverless. Then we are going to see what serverless really means, so what's the fun with serverless. Then we are going to try to understand more serverless, so what are the main properties, what are some common definitions, what are the pros and cons. Then I'm going to show you a real use case, and we are going to literally try to build it using all the serverless technologies. Finally, we're going to go even deeper on pros and cons and see all the trade-offs that we have to make when we decide to use serverless. And then I'm going to give you just a few tips if you want to get started on, I don't know, maybe which technologies you want to choose or things like that. So let's start with chapter one. So regarding this chapter, I actually even wrote an article on my blog where maybe if you are interested in the story and finding out maybe more links, you can read it from there. But I'm going to give you a summary in the first part of this talk. And the reason why I think it's important to understand the story of the cloud computing from its beginning to serverless is because in general, in everything we do in life as human beings, we need to understand history to really know what's going on today. So as any other good story that involves the web, it starts with this guy, Sir Tim Berners-Lee, who invented the World Wide Web. And it was around, it started probably before 89, but the first website was published in 1991. And it was actually the CERN website. So initially, the web was thought as a way to publish research papers. So you can imagine something very, very static. You have text, you maybe have a few images, but that's it. Every document is just a research paper. And that probably is going to tell you a bit why the web looks as it looks today. So it's mostly based on text, images, and we have this idea of document or document object model. So the interesting thing is that as soon as it came out as a research tool, a lot of people started to understand the potential and very quickly grew out the research space, and it started to become a tool that today we know can run even very complex applications. So it's not just based on text and images. But the problem with the web at the very beginning was that it was very hard to create your own web page and make it available to other people. And the issue was that initially there was no infrastructure. So basically, you had to create the infrastructure yourself. You had to buy servers. You had to put them somewhere safe. You have to connect them to a stable electricity line. You had to have a stable internet connection. Then you needed to make sure that everything was working. You installed the right operating system, the right web servers. And finally, you put some files in there, and people could access through them. Oh yeah, maybe you also needed to register a domain, make sure you had a stable IP. You know, it's not that simple. And imagine at some point your website was becoming very famous and you needed to scale a bit more. So you needed to put maybe two machines, not just one. So you can imagine how difficult it was and how expensive it was at the time to actually host a website. Things started to get a little bit better around 1995, when the concept of web hosting started to be popularized. And probably most of the merit goes to websites like GeoCities, that they were giving hosting service for free. But basically, the idea of web hosting, I'm sure most of you will know that, but is that you don't need to host yourself all the infrastructure. You just get somehow access to an existing infrastructure. In this case, it will be GeoCities to give you maybe an FTP access. So you go to this web server, you publish your files, and then it's going to be available through a URL. And this changed a lot, because at that point, a lot of people started to create websites, even for fun, not just businesses or research. So that really made a difference in making the web grow at the time. Then at some point in 1997, there was an interesting group of researchers that created this thing called Globus Alliance. And Globus Alliance was famous because they created something that they called meta computing, which basically is the idea that we thought for a while, okay, we need bigger and bigger machines, because if we need to do more stuff, a bigger machine will do it. At this point in time with meta computing, they started to define rules on which you can start to parallelize tasks and maybe take one big job and split it into multiple parts and maybe assign every single part to different machines so you can get things done at different scale. And I don't know how many of you here ever heard of the project SETI, which was Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. So basically, it was based on the framework that come out from this metacomputing. And the guy was Ian Foster, which was one of the founding members of the Globus Alliance. And again, this is important in the context of cloud computing, because it was the first time that we started to think, OK, maybe we can split the work and parallelizing rather than trying to get more and more powerful machines. In 1999, you have to think that we already had pretty complex websites. We had things like Amazon.com were widespread. And if you think about Amazon.com, it's not just reading documents. You actually can do a lot of things in there. You can put products in a cart. You can search for things. Then you can purchase. So it's a complete application, I will say. And at the time, Salesforce started to emerge, and their proposition to the market, that literally was their marketing campaign, was called End the Software, which for them meant, okay, the web itself is sufficiently complex to allow us to do everything on the browser, and we don't need to build desktop animation, desktop applications anymore. Which I think at the time was a very big statement to make, but today we give it for granted that we don't really need desktop applications anymore. And Salesforce, because of that, was a very successful company. They were one of the first companies building lots of softwares, only web-based. Then in 2001, another big innovation was VMware that released ESXi, which was one of the first mainstream virtualization for framework, for let's say web or in general cloud computing. For the cloud computing space, even though at the time it wasn't still already called cloud computing. But the idea was that you, as a cloud provider, if we want to use this term already, you needed to have a lot of hardware, because with this hardware, you basically create the space for your customers to use and publish products online. And with virtualization, it was a very, very big difference, because now you didn't need to provision a lot of hardware of different sizes for the size that was needed for your customers. You just needed to provision as much hardware as you needed, and then you can virtualize virtual machine on it. So if I am a new customer and I want to use your provider, then I'm just going to say to you, OK, I need this kind of machine, and maybe in 2 minutes you can give me already the access. It's not going to be a real physical machine, but it's going to have the same capabilities. So basically, the management of this infrastructure was getting much more efficient and easier. And this is probably what led to the idea in Amazon to start to rent their computing power. So Amazon was already a giant. This was already 2002. And Amazon was having a lot of computing power. They had their own server farms. And they started to think, OK, we don't really use this much power. We need to have it because there are peak seasons. But Most of the time we don't use it. What can we do with it? And they had the great idea to start to think about, okay, maybe we can sell it as a service. And even if today we know this is a great idea and AWS is a great business, it was actually pretty difficult for them to find a value proposition. So they had to launch the product 3 times before it was actually successful. So from 2002 to 2006, they really struggled a lot to create a message to the market to say, okay, this is something that people should really use to build their own and build and release their own apps. But in 2006, they figured out what was the value that developers were looking for, and they created this package that was consisting of EC2, so virtual machines, S3, so virtual storage, and then SQS as a way to create more scalable jobs on the cloud. And this was called infrastructure as a service, but eventually became the concept of cloud computing. Then another great invention, how many of you ever used Heroku? Right, so it was actually invented in 2009, but funny story, it wasn't a platform to release software, but was just an online editor for Ruby on Rails. But funny enough, even though they got a lot of funding for this idea, they quickly realized it wasn't what the market needed. And they figured out that deploying on the cloud Ruby application was much more painful than writing them. So they really figured out, okay, we don't really need to build an IDE online, but maybe we should build a platform that allows people to distribute the Ruby Rails application much, much easier. And what they figure out later is, of course, they could extend these principles to support other frameworks and other languages. But they were very smart in shifting the concept of you don't need an infrastructure itself. The infrastructure is just there underneath. You don't need to worry too much about it. You just have to tell me how your application looks like, and we are going to manage a lot of the infrastructure. So we are going to deal with things like scalability and things like that. And the interesting thing is that one of the co-founders, Adam Wiggins, is also the guy that wrote the manifesto of 12-factor apps, I think it's called, which is basically the guideline that today many, many companies follow to create scalable applications. Oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you that even this company was very successful and Salesforce acquired it, and they made so much money that at the point they could even hire the Ruby inventor, and he is now the architect of the company. Then another great invention in 2011, it was initially called Envolve and then Firebase. The idea at the time was, okay, we have this concept of cloud computing. We can virtualize processing power, basically. But why we never try to give databases as a service? And specifically, they were thinking of a real-time database where you can easily get a push notification every time there is a change. So again, this turned out to be a very successful idea. The company itself was very successful and was acquired by Google. And then they used all this tooling around it to build even more capabilities and create back-end tools so that you can build apps very quickly on this technology. I don't know why nobody ever came up with a term like real-time database as a service or database as a service, but I think that should be a thing. Then very similar idea, parse.com. How many of you ever used it? Great, I guess you were trying to build mobile apps because that was the focus. So these guys realized that if you are a mobile developer, you already have a lot of complexity in your mind because you have to deal with platform-specific things for Android, iOS, maybe even Microsoft. And you don't, if you are especially a startup with a small team, you don't want to deal with things like, okay, how do we build the APIs for our app? How do we build the user authentication system? How do we build an entity storage for the kind of data that we manage? How do we build a system that does push notifications? We just want to focus on building nice interfaces, a very good UX, and making sure that everything works in all the different marketplaces. So these guys actually figured out that there was a market in providing all these backend services in a way that you just pay per the usage you need. And this was the beginning of backend as a service. Interesting story, also Parse.com was a successful company, this time acquired by Facebook, not by Google, as Firebase. But the other part is that while Firebase still exists under the Google umbrella, Facebook decided to shut down Parse.com, and they actually released all the code as open source. So if you still want to use it, you can run it on your own server. Then another great inventions, Docker. And by Solomon Ikes, I think it was presented in a Python conference. And the idea of Docker was actually because this guy, together with other people, was trying to build a competitor for Heroku. It was called .cloud. And they wanted to create a level of abstraction that should have allowed them to run their application in a much faster way and an easier way to manage. So they figure out, instead of creating virtual machines, maybe we can do something with Linux container that is much, much lighter. It turned out that the company itself wasn't very successful, and they eventually was shut down. But Docker itself was an incredible invention. Like, every provider and every major company started to invest more in Docker. And together, we know that every cloud company uses Docker. Which brings us to the next step, where okay, Docker is just an idea, that a concept that allows us to virtualize processes using the Linux features, the namespaces, and things like that. But in reality, we want to use it at scale, which means we have many servers, and we want to share processes or maybe make sure that processes can talk to each other. So we need some level of orchestration between different servers that uses Docker. So a lot of companies, again, invested money and time and created tools to do that, like Kubernetes, Worm, Nomad, CoreOS. And we are talking of companies like Google itself, or HashiCorp in the case of Nomad, or the Docker company itself. So very, very big investment. And today, this is still a big trend. We are pretty close to the end of the story part. The last step is AWS Lambda, launched in 2014. It was the first time we started to hear the term function as a service. And the idea was very disruptive, because at this point, we realized, OK, the only thing that I care about is my business logic. I don't want to know anything else. I just want to write my function, and you run it for me. And the other incredible invention was that we were thinking before as web servers, where you have to spin up your own web server, it's always running, and you have to accept HTTP and you react to HTTP. Now the perspective is shifting a lot, because it's all event-driven. So you have to say, OK, run this function only when something happens. And that something, of course, might even be an HTTP call. But your code is only running the moment that the action happens. So. OK, why now we can talk about serverless? Because all these things that I told you before naturally led us to have this term serverless, which is nothing else than a collection of different ideas and principles that we are going to see in a moment. But if you want a definition by AWS, it's very lengthy, so I'm going to try to resume it a little bit. But the idea is that serverless is it doesn't refer to a specific technology, but more a methodology for building serverless applications. And basically, the idea is that you don't need to provision any server. So you don't have to know, let's say, I don't know, which operative system is running on the server, or how many servers do you have underneath your application. And you can focus only on writing business logic and deliver your product fast. There is a much, much lighter definition by Auth0, which says the essence of serverless trend is the absence of the server concept during software development, which again means you don't have to worry about servers. And yeah, many people still think, OK, but there is a server somewhere, which is true, right? I mean, it's not that now we are really running code in the cloud, like a physical cloud. So that, again, the idea is that you as a developer don't even need to know what is the server. So I found this commit strip very funny. But if you want to spend your time to read it carefully, there is a link in there. OK, so now let's try to understand more what serverless really is. And here we have a very interesting perspective from Matt McKay, and where he described it with this visualization that serverless is basically the new level of abstraction. And we constantly are building abstraction layers as developers. And the very first layer was the bare metal approach, where you basically have to do everything. And then we started to pile on layers, so virtual private servers, infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and now we have serverless. But what really defines serverless? And there are four different things that people often refer to as pillars of serverless. So it's not just about function as a service. So the first thing, as I told you already, is that there is no server management. We don't want to know about the servers at all, what's happening with them. But the other very, very important feature of serverless is that you have flexible scaling, which basically means if at some point your application will require a lot more resources, that is going to happen automatically. You don't have to know it. And as well, if at some point your application is not as used as it was maybe a few hours ago, they will scale down all the resources, and you don't have to worry about it. Also, you have high availability. So once you publish your serverless application, the cloud provider is going to guarantee that your application is there up and running. So if one of their servers breaks, you don't have to worry. They will do whatever is required to make your application always there up and running. And then the other very important property of serverless is that you never have to pay for idle. So if you have built an application and you are very unlucky, nobody's using it, you are not paying anything. So you are not even paying for the cost of the server that you would have allocated yourself if you were going to deploy this application with a regular server. The other perspective on serverless is that there are many layers that try to address different needs when we're building a serverless application. And again, it's not only about function as a service. Function as a service is just the first layer, which gives us the compute power, a way to define what our application should do, the business logic. But then we need a lot more. We need data, places where to store this data. And it can be in the form of objects or files, if you want, like S3. But it can even be a database, like DynamoDB, Firebase, and other serverless databases. The important thing here, again, is that if you are storing data, but you are not really using it, you shouldn't pay as much money. So the model, the pricing model of all these products is that the more you use them, the more you pay. But if you have very, very low consumptions, you are going to pay a small amount of money. Instead, if you deploy your own, I don't know, let's say Postgres cluster, you are always going to pay the allocation of the servers, even if nobody is ever making a query. So the other layer is messaging and streaming. How do we exchange messages between different parts of the application? And we have tools like SQS, SNS, so publish-subscribe model, queuing systems. Other layer, very important one, especially if you are building mobile application, is user management and identity. And there are different solutions as well that fall into the serverless category, like Okta, Auth0, or Cognito in AWS. Then we have monitoring and deployment. How do we make sure that, for example, we manage our logs? How do we gather metrics? How do we make sure that our application is performing correctly? And there are, of course, tools that allow us to do that. Like in AWS, we have CloudWatch, I believe. And then we have external tools like Datadog, or yeah, there are many of them. And then the last layer is the edge, which basically means how do we expose the functionality of our application to the end user, which is basically the thin slice that is actually public in our application. And if we are talking about an API, in AWS you can use API Gateway, but we probably can talk also about files that we can distribute through HTTP, so like a CDN, and you have CDNs in AWS and in other major cloud providers, or you have independent CDNs like Netlify. Okay, now probably the main question is, okay, yeah, looks interesting, probably I'm going to save a lot of money, but what can I actually build with serverless? And I would say that you can build most of the applications that are out there commonly in your developer life. Like you can build mobile backends, you can build APIs and microservices, you can build data processing pipelines, webhooks, bots and integrations for Slack or whatever, GitHub. Then you can build even IoT backends, so you can actually control the logic that runs inside IoT devices. Or you can even build single-page web applications. Of course, you cannot build all the possible applications, but realistically, most of the application you are going to build can be built with serverless, with the serverless approach. And I can tell you some of the things that I contribute with building. And the first one is full stack bulletin that I already mentioned at the beginning of my presentation. Then there is a middleware framework for AWS Lambda. And those two are my open source serverless project. But I also had a chance to work on enterprise serverless applications. And the first one was basically a number of solutions for the UK energy industry. Was a trading platform, a billing engine, a market data aggregator. So pretty complex applications. We were able to build them 100% serverless. And today, I'm working on a big data pipeline for the company Vectra that I mentioned at the beginning, and allows to make a decent amount of data, like about 1 to 5 terabytes a day per customer, searchable. And it uses, it's not fully serverless, but it uses many steps of the pipeline I'll build with Lambda and other serverless technologies. So I mentioned already what is the execution model of serverless. You have an event, and this event triggers a function. And this model is, if you want to simplify it in your mind, is a bit like if this, then that, which means if something happens, then do something else. An example can be, OK, if a new CSV file is saved in the object storage, then trigger a Lambda that will process it and save its record to a database. Or maybe if there is an HTTP request to the API gateway that is saying get products, trigger a Lambda that actually implements the products API. So basically, it's going to retrieve the products from a database and return them as a JSON. Or again, you can even have scheduled events. Like if it's 2 a.m., then scrape the weather forecast for the next days and maybe do something with it. OK, this is a JavaScript conference. So at this point, you're probably wondering, where is JavaScript? I mean, you are only talking for half an hour about serverless stuff. And you will find out that JavaScript is probably one of the preferred languages when you are building serverless application. It's not the only one, but it's the one that every cloud provider supports. So it's probably a good choice, especially if you are here. I believe you are already interested in JavaScript. And you can use JavaScript for the front-end part, of course, when you are building the, let's say, the front-end for a web application. And you can use any web framework. You can use React, Angular, Vue.js, because eventually you only have files that you are serving through a CDN. But in the back-end, it's probably more interesting. You can use Node.js in all the function as a service providers. So you basically can write your business logic with JavaScript. And it has interesting properties. Most of the time, as a faster startup, compared at least to languages like Java, that they are a bit slower to bootstrap. Then in most of the cloud providers, you can use all the NPM modules that you want, because eventually you just create a zip file with all your modules, and that's shipped to the cloud. And then you can even support other languages or dialects, like you like to use TypeScript. Well, compile it to JavaScript and then ship it to the cloud. You want to use Clojure script or be able to use new features of the language, you can do that as well. OK, now if we want to start to think, I want to write my first Lambda, in the case at least of AWS, or whatever other function as a service is going to look very similar to this one, how do we write it? And I told you it's just a function. So literally, the way you write it, you export a function. And this function needs to have a specific signature, needs to receive an event, a context, and callback. Event is a JSON object that basically tells you details about the event that triggered the execution. We will see some examples later, but just think, if it's a new file on S3, the event is going to tell you the name of the file, what is the bucket where you save the files, and things like that. Then you have the context, and context allows you to read properties of the execution context, like, I don't know, the number of milliseconds that your Lambda was running, and even to modify some characteristic of the context. For example, in JavaScript, you can say, I don't want to wait the event loop to be empty to finish the Lambda. So you can use these context objects to access these properties. And finally, we have callback, because our Lambda is asynchronous. So you can do all the asynchronous stuff that you want. And when you are done, you just need to call the callback. OK, now I'm going to show you a real use case. So few days ago, I got a card saying, you have to build this stuff. And this stuff is called Search for Threats Using Network Metadata. And the use case is, as a security researcher, I want to have an API that allows me to search across network metadata. And network metadata is served in the form of files that are available on a shared FTP drive, so that I can find and validate potential security threats on the network. Just to rephrase this, in the industry where I'm working right now, it's very interesting for security researchers to be able to read as much information as possible from the network traffic, and they will have to do a lot of searches to figure out if something is really a threat or not, or how much this threat is big. So in this example, they are getting this data in the form of files through FTP, but of course it's not something searchable. So we have to build an API that allows them to make search inside these files. So this is a potential implementation that we can do using serverless principles. So on one side, we have our network drive that it can be accessed through FTP, where somebody is putting those metadata files. And on the other side, we want to build this service that uses this data and make it available through an API. And since we want to use AWS, we are going to use API Gateway to provide, let's say, the public-facing endpoint. So the first thing that we have to build, of course, is something that allows us to synchronize the data that is in the FTP drive with something that we can manage and build APIs on top of it. So we are going to create a Lambda that runs every once in a while, let's say every 2 hours maybe. And this Lambda is going to check, are there new files in there? And if there are, it's going to copy them into an S3 bucket. Then the second step is going to be, OK, we are going to put a trigger in this S3 bucket. And every time there is a new file saved in there, we are going to trigger another Lambda. And this Lambda is basically going to read the content of the file, figure out what is the format there. Maybe there is a specific standard. We can assume it's JSON, can be a CSV, can be anything. But it's going to know how to read the content of the file. And then it's going to create something that can be stored in Elasticsearch. So eventually, we want to expose a search functionality. So Elasticsearch seems to be like a right fit for the job we want to do. So this Lambda reads every new file and understands the content, creates records for Elasticsearch, and pushes them to Elasticsearch. And in this case, of course, since we are in AWS, we can use the Elasticsearch as a service offered by Elasticsearch. Now, at this point, we only built something that runs on the backend and constantly keeps this Elasticsearch server up to date. But how do we actually consume this data? We said we have an API gateway, but we have no way yet to reach our Elasticsearch database. So we have to write another Lambda, and this Lambda will be able to access the Elasticsearch. And of course, we invoke it every time there is an API request on a specific endpoint. So now there are these two flows. On one side, we keep the Elasticsearch always up to date. On the other side, we are ready to respond to search requests through this new Lambda. And of course, at this point, anybody can use those APIs, a user, another service. So you are actually exposing a new feature through an HTTP API. OK, now let's see how the first Lambda looks like. We said we will have a schedule. And this schedule triggers a Lambda. But what does it mean, trigger? It actually means that it invokes the Lambda, passing this object as event of the function. So the function will actually receive this object in there. Regarding schedule, it's not really important. Maybe you just want to know the time when the schedule was triggered. But most of the time, you just want something that triggers your Lambda every once in a while. So the content of this event, most of the time, is not very relevant. And your Lambda basically is going to look like this. This is pseudocode or commented code or something like that. So basically, the first step, we need to connect to the FTP server. Then we are going to get the list of files. Then we are going to compare this list of files with the ones we already have in S3. We make a diff and figure out what are the new files there. We are going to read them and copy and stream that inside S3. And finally, we're just going to invoke the callback to say, OK, the job is done. Let's wait for the next cycle. So this way, we are actually synchronizing the files that are in the FTP server into the S3 bucket. Then the second lambda is load lambda, which is triggered every time there is an S3 object. And this time we get an event that looks like this. And it is more interesting because here we have information that tells us, okay, what is the new file? What is the name? And what is the bucket name that is containing this file? So we actually will need this information when we are running the lambda, because this way we can actually read the correct file, which is actually what we do in the step one. We read these parameters from the event, then we read the file and deserialize the records, and then we can use the bulk API from Elasticsearch to store this data. And finally, we invoke the callback. Now the Lambda API, it's very interesting as well. So we are using API Gateway, and once we configure it, API Gateway is going to send, is going to invoke the Lambda passing a specific event. And this event basically represents an HTTP request. You can read most of the fields here. So we have a body, we have a resource, we have headers, and we have query string parameters, which is actually what we are interested into, because this is how we are exposing the search functionality to the end users. So they will put a query string parameter with the query that they want to throw at Elasticsearch. So this time we just need to read those details from the event. And then we can issue the query to Elasticsearch, read the response from Elasticsearch, and convert it to something, maybe a JSON object that can be consumed from the client. Okay, at this point you're probably wondering, you wrote three functions, but there is a lot in between these three functions. There is a lot that is happening. Where do we define this stuff? Where do we define the orchestration? And in reality, there are many ways to do that. One way is what I like to call clicky-clicky. So you just go to the AWS web interface and you start to click around, like create a new Lambda, then assign S3 as an event source for this Lambda, then maybe create a policy to tell this Lambda can read from this bucket and things like that. This is good for the first time you are using serverless, because you're probably going to learn what are the principles. But of course, it doesn't scale. Like, it's not something you can reproduce. If you build a new version of your application, then it's not something you can deploy manually by clicking 200 buttons again. So of course, there are better approaches, and they are basically infrastructure as code tools. And the most famous in AWS is CloudFormation, but in my opinion, it's very verbose. And probably also in AWS opinion, since they built a shorter version, which is called SAM, that allows you to define the same things, but with a much nicer syntax. Then we have tools like the serverless framework and Terraform that can be used as well to define all the serverless infrastructure. So in our specific example, I want to show you how to build all the orchestration with the serverless framework, because I think it's probably one of the easiest way to do it. And basically, it's just a YAML file. And this YAML file, you can see, contains the three functions here. So we have sync, load, and API. And then for every function, we have to tell what is really the source code. Where do we find the source code for this function? And we use the index.js file, and we look for an export called sync lambda. But then the other important thing that you probably were wondering, OK, how do we know how to connect to the FTP server, for example? And you can pass this information through environment variables. And then also, we configure the event. So who is going to trigger this lambda? A schedule every 2 hours. Same here. We have the code, we have environment variables, and then we are saying S3 is going to trigger this Lambda. And finally, an API, which is using, again, environment variable to be able to connect to Elasticsearch, and then is going to accept calls from metadata/search. And once you are using the serverless framework, there is a very nice command line that you can use, which allows you to just do SLS deploy. And this SLS deploy is going to read this file, is going to understand what are the resources, and is going to compare them with what you already have in AWS. And then they are going to be able to create a zip file with all your source code and update your AWS environment with all the new features and the new version of the code. So the first time you deploy, they're going to create an API gateway, they're going to create an S3 bucket, they're going to create the three lambdas. But the second time you deploy, they're going to make a diff and just deploy what's new. So if you just change a line of code, they're going to just deploy the new version of the lambda, but they are not going to touch API gateway or S3. So this is very convenient. Now, just one thing that I want to punctualize, I didn't have to worry about many things. My application was done, and I could have done this work in maybe 3 or 4 days. And you can imagine building this with your own server is probably going to take weeks and not days, because you have to worry about things like, I don't know, what type of virtual machine do I need? What operative system? How do I make the operative system always up to date with the latest security patches? How much disk space do I need? How to handle retries and failures, logs and many things like that, metrics. Of course, in serverless, you get all of this for free. It's not perfect. There are a lot of defaults. Sometimes you have to figure out how to change the defaults, but most of the time it just works. So let's move to a very quick list of what are the main pros and cons. So the first pro, I hope it's obvious at this point, is that you can focus a lot more on delivering business value, which means you go to the market much faster because you only have to worry about building the right features and not how to maintain the server for these features, or how do I scale this server if this feature becomes very successful. But of course, the immediate drawback is that you are going to lock in yourself a lot more with the cloud provider. At the moment, the scene of serverless is very fragmented. There is no standard, so every provider is doing it in a different way. So if you build a Lambda in AWS, it's probably relatively easier to migrate to Azure Functions because the spec is similar, but you have to do some work to change the code. But then maybe when you are using S3, it doesn't map to the storage service in Azure. So all the serverless tools that you are using doesn't necessarily map to every cloud provider. So you will have a lot of vendor lock-in. Then the other pro is that you have optimal resource allocation, because the serverless environment is going to figure out if you need an extra server or you can remove a server, and you are just going to pay for the amount of compute that you are doing. But also, it's not magic. As you see, you still have to write some configuration, and you have to understand what's going on behind the scene. It's probably easier than putting up your own server, but still, you have to understand what is the paradigm. Then you have auto-scalability. But as well, there is something called the cold start problem. Since you don't have your server up and running all the time, but just when an event happens, it means that the first time somebody's triggering that event, it's not going to immediately respond because it needs to trigger the environment that contains your function. So, and this is a very interesting problem, and there is a link there if you want to figure out more. And there are, of course, ways you can mitigate this problem. High availability, if server goes down, you don't have to worry, your application is still going to be available. But again, there is a con, which is most of the cloud providers will give you soft and hard limits, which means that your application needs to fit in specific use cases. And sometimes you can ask to increase the limits. For example, one limit can be the number of buckets that you can create in S3. And there are reasonable ways where you can get more, but some limits are hard. And one example is a Lambda function can compute a maximum time of 5 minutes. So if you're building something that can take more than 5 minutes, serverless is not ideal for your use case. And that's not something you can increase. Then pay-per usage, you don't pay for idle, big advantage. And I can tell you that when I was working in the electricity company, we were serving around 20 customers, which was a decent amount of requests, and the highest bill I've seen was $5. So you can run a business with a very low budget on this. Then the other problem is that local development, testing, and debugging is still kind of tricky. We don't have many tools, and many providers only think that you have to do your stuff online, which of course is not always ideal. So as a developer, you will probably struggle a bit to figure out what is the best approach for you to do local development, testing, and debugging. But there is a growing ecosystem. So there is a number of products, open source libraries, and framework that can help you with that. So it's going to get better. Which also means that maybe some old technologies are not going to fit very well. So if you have to migrate from an old system, maybe it's not something very feasible, or it's going to require a lot of effort. So that's it. Now I'm just going to give you a few very quick tips on how to get started if you really want to do serverless. But if you didn't believe me so far, maybe you don't believe all the things I told you, believe those companies. They are just few companies for which you can find use cases online, and they are using serverless at scale. Like one of the most interesting is probably Netflix or Expedia, and you can find use cases on the AWS website itself. They are using serverless at massive scales, so it means that there are big advantages for them if they decided to migrate most of their infrastructure to serverless. Okay, how to get started? So I showed you examples with AWS and Lambda, but of course it's not the only way. There are many, many solutions out there. If you're using, for example, the Azure cloud, you can use Azure Functions and all their other serverless tools. But if you want to run stuff on-premise, which is a bit probably contradicting for the serverless principles, you can still do it because there are a lot of tools that you can also run on-premise. For example, if you have a Kubernetes cluster, you can run Kubeless or OpenFaaS and have a function as a service environment in your Kubernetes cluster. So finally, why do I believe that serverless is the future? Well, mostly because I think it's the right level of abstraction that allows us as developers to focus more and more on the business logic and delivering values rather than strictly technical things like what servers do I need or how do I scale this server. But if I want to be more specific, there are two big reasons, two big advantages, which are opportunity to deliver value to the customer and pay only for the used resources. So this is a huge competitive factor, especially if you are a startup or a small team. You can build prototypes very, very quickly, release them to the customer, and then you can easily scale them if your product is successful. Okay, so I expect this is going to be your reaction, right? Okay, maybe not. So don't get so excited, because you should approach this with care. So I told you that serverless is a great abstraction. You have a lot of advantages, but maybe it doesn't fit your use case. So be sure that the thing you are building actually fit the server's methodology. And also, I don't suggest you to just really migrate all your applications. Do that only if you see a real advantage in cost or in maintainability or in scalability. But if you do just for the practice, don't do it. Keep your application as it is. And maybe the next feature you are building, you can consider if it makes sense to do it as a serverless feature. Because of course, serverless is not all in. You can build only parts of your application with serverless. So be smart about it and maybe figure out where it makes sense or not. So that's it. Thank you very much.